And again, it's time for Bridget Hillary and the News, the dramatic but sometimes fascinating story of a girl radio reporter who dares to tell the truth in her hard-hitting weekly broadcasts. As our scene opens today, Bridget's childhood sweetheart, Assistant Secretary of Defense Harlow Fordyce, is just entering the rehearsal room of the Amalgamated Broadcasting System.
My, what a surprise, Harlow. We haven't seen each other since you gave me your fudge brownie at our sixth grade class picnic. I must say you've aged.
Yes, I suppose I have, Bridget. But the pressure on me at the Pentagon would break any man. And that, in fact, is why I came to see you.
2 minutes to airtime, Miss Hillary.
Why must you tell the world that I have been seen hanging around Communist diplomatic headquarters? Surely you can't still be thinking of that childhood picnic we held on the lawn of the Soviet embassy.
Well, of course, that is exactly what I'm thinking of. I remember how the guard came out to chase us away, but you lingered behind to chat with him. Now, that's a bad scene for a top Defense Department official, Harlow.
Well, I wasn't in the Defense Department then. I was only 11 years old.
1 minute to airtime, Miss Hillary.
I was merely asking the embassy guard if I could use their bathroom, and what you're trying to make out of that now would break any man.
Well, I have no personal desire to destroy you, Harlow, but I can't let a long-time friendship interfere with my job of reporting the news. And if you're the one who's passing secrets along to the commies, the public has a right to know.
Bridget, it's been 30 years since I spoke to that embassy guard, and even then I found that he didn't understand a word of English.
You're on the air, Miss Hillary.
Well, I don't want to overstay my welcome, since you probably have to be getting into the studio. But I had to make this one last effort to show you I'm innocent.
Well, you may think you're innocent now, Harlow, but perhaps you'll see things differently after my broadcast tonight. I'm going to reveal the fact that you brought 2 fudge brownies to our class picnic, and only the one you gave me has ever been accounted for. I suppose it was the other one that you slipped to the guard that had the microfilm baked inside.
Bridget, that's a wild accusation with no facts to support it whatsoever. But when the story reaches Washington, it'll be enough to break a man.
Your program's off the air now, Miss Hillary. When you didn't show up in the studio, they filled the time with a very long weather report.
Well, I must go, Bridget. I'll need all the time I can get to prepare my defense.
Well, it's been grand seeing you again, Harlow. And remember, I haven't done this to hurt you. I've done it to protect the national security of the United States of America.
And so Bridget's personal affection for Harlow Fordyce proves weaker than her love for the country where she may have been born. But can fudge brownies really mean that little to any woman? Be sure to join us next time when we'll hear the guard at the Soviet embassy say,
"Well, maybe the same person, but he was shorter then."
That's in the next exciting episode of Bridget Hillary and the News. Our Bob and Ray program to encourage young inventors is still in full swing. We haven't mentioned this for a while. We got 3 more letters last week from people who seek publicity and financial backing to get their inventions on the market. And our staff picked out the most promising letter. As a result, we have Mr. Glendennon McKenzie here with us. That's a real Scotch name, isn't it, sir?
Well, I really couldn't say. I've become so lost in the world of science that I really don't pay much attention to my name. In fact, if I didn't carry my driver's license and social security card around with me, I'd probably forget who I was.
Well, when we sent for Glendennon McKenzie, you came, so I guess that's who you are.
I guess so.
As I understand it, Mr. McKenzie, you've invented a new miracle plant food that could revolutionize American agriculture?
That's right.
Tell
By using the McKenzie mineral supplement, your average farmer could harvest a crop every week or 10 days during the summer months.
Wow. Boy, there's one thing about that kind of thing that puzzles me. You're from Chicago. How did a city dweller like yourself happen to come up with a purely agricultural invention?
Well, actually, I didn't remember that I'm from Chicago, but I do know how I got the idea for the invention.
Well, will you tell us about that?
Well, a couple of years ago, I was driving through the Midwest, and I noticed how many farmers were sitting on their front porches or lying on hammocks and things like that. Finally, I stopped and asked one of them why he wasn't working.
I see. What happened? Did he hit you?
No. He said he didn't have anything to do. He was just sitting around waiting for his crops to grow. And that's how I got the idea for inventing something to make the stuff grow faster.
Well, now, you've brought into the studio a corn stalk planted in a flower pot, and you told us if you put McKenzie mineral supplement on it, we'd see it grow right here in the studio, on the air. That's pretty hard to believe.
Yes, it's pretty hard to believe. In fact, I don't even remember saying it. But I'll be glad to put plant food on this corn stalk and see what happens.
All right, I think this is going to be interesting. You go right ahead, will you?
Now, you'll notice that the mineral supplement is a white powdery mixture, and I pour just about a teaspoon of it around the base of the cornstalk like this.
Whoa! Hey, that's terrible, Mr. McKenzie. The stalk shot up so fast it went right through the window of the client's booth up there.
Sometimes it's wise to dilute the supplement with water.
Well, I wouldn't worry about that. I think it's just time that you get it out of here. It's really made a big mess.
I may have trouble getting it through the door. Say, if any offers come in for financial backing, you have my address. I don't remember it offhand.
No, we'll be in touch with you somehow.
Okay, goodbye.
Goodbye. And now the makers of Tingle, the long-wearing dental floss created from spun glass fiber, invite you to join us for another exciting adventure of Elmer W. Litzinger, Spy.
My name is Elmer W. Litzinger, Spy. Some of the toughest espionage assignments our government can hand out come my way. Recently, I was back at the home office, catching up on paperwork between dangerous jobs, and late one night, a strange-looking character, armed with a single-action, manually operated broom, entered without even knocking. He made his way over to my desk and spoke.
Sorry I burst in without knocking, sir, but there's never anybody working in this office.
I know. I'm usually out of the country on some dangerous assignment. The name is Elmer W. Litzinger, spy.
Oh, pleased to meet you. I'm Stuart C. Tinglehoff, janitor. Do you want all this stuff here in the wastebasket thrown out?
Yes, I've been cleaning out my files, and those are all obsolete documents that have been declassified now.
Oh, I'm sorry to hear that. I was hoping there might be a drawing in there of the R-427 long-range rocket, the one that our enemies don't even know we have. But I guess that wouldn't be obsolete or just declassified, would it?
No, definitely not. The R-427 is top secret. The plans are locked up tight in my file cabinet here.
Well, I can sure understand why. Just imagine a rocket that only weighs 24 pounds, but is capable of hitting any spot in the world. I'd swear a thing like that could never be built.
Well, you're only amazed because you don't know about its radical new design. Here, let me get the plans out of the file so I can show you how it works.
Yes. This is real nice of you, taking so much time to show a top secret to a lowly janitor.
You're certainly entitled to see it. After all, you're an American citizen who pays taxes.
Well, actually, that doesn't happen to be true, but I'm much obliged anyway. Why don't you just lay the plans out there under the light so I can get a good snapshot of them with my camera?
All right. Would you like for me to pose behind the desk here, smiling and pointing to them?
No, I don't think so. People who asked me to take the picture didn't mention having you in it at all.
Well, yes, maybe they just collect photos of secret diagrams.
Probably. Well, that's getting to be a very popular hobby in the foreign country where they live.
Well, I'm sorry that these diagrams cover several pages. I hope you don't run out of film.
Oh, don't worry about that. I've been carrying a lot of film around in my overalls for more than 3 weeks, just hoping a chance like this might come up.
Well, it certainly shows a healthy interest in what we do around here. How long have you been working for the spy department?
A little more than 3 weeks. I replaced Walter Dimmick as night janitor on this floor.
Oh, yeah, I remember Walter. What's he doing now?
Nothing. He was murdered. His body's been stuffed in an unused locker in the basement.
Is that so? Do the authorities have any idea who killed him?
No, they don't even know he's dead yet. I'm using his ID and punching his time card every night, so everybody thinks Walter's still around.
Well, that seems a little irregular, and I suppose I should file a report about it. But since you're being kind enough to cover for him while he's absent, we'll just keep it our little secret.
Good.
And I'll leave a note for the chief agent saying, "Offer situation found to be normal by Elmer W. Litzinger, spy."
Friends, there's no better way to keep this fine entertainment on the air than by patronizing our generous sponsors. So rush out now and buy several 500-yard rolls of Tingle, the dental floss that never shreds because it's made of spun glass fiber. And join us soon for more exciting adventures in the career of Elmer W. Litzinger, spy.
And now, the United States Mint, one of the nation's leading producers of fine new money, presents another dramatic story from the files of the Emergency Ward.
Greetings and welcome. I'm Dr. Gerhard Snutten, handsome young physician who's not yet established a practice of his own. Instead, I work in the emergency ward of a big city hospital. The emergency ward is a place where the story of human misery unfolds 24 hours a day. Take the other evening, for example. I was utilizing a spare moment to make some vital calculations when my associate, Nurse Rudehouse, turned to me and said,
"Why are you scribbling all those figures on the back of that sports car magazine, Doctor?"
"I was just trying to determine how many tonsillectomies I'd have to perform in order to buy a new 1976 Alfa Hispano. It would have to be either 8 operations at $3,000 each or 3,000 operations at $8 each."
"Well, normally a tonsillectomy costs more than $8, but less than $3,000. Can't you set your fees somewhere in between?"
"No, I'm sorry. The car I want to buy costs $24,000. The only numbers that go into $24,000 evenly are 8 and 3,000.
"I think that man who just came in is blowing his whistle at us, Doctor."
"So it would appear, Nurse Rudehouse. Stand back and let me handle this. My good man, speaking as the physician in charge, while Dr. Moberly is on vacation, I can assure you that making noise in this hospital is forbidden. Is that clear?"
"Well, I think he's trying to tell you that he can't get the whistle out of his mouth, Doctor."
"Nonsense. Anyone can take a whistle out of his mouth, unless he has some neurotic reason for keeping it in there. Sir, suppose you start by telling me about your unhappy childhood."
"Well, Doctor, I really don't think you can psychoanalyze a person who just stands there blowing a whistle. You have to take the whistle out of his mouth first."
No, he has to remove it of his own free will in order to be cured. However, we shouldn't be discussing this case in front of the patient. Sir, would you be good enough to wait in the hall?"
"Hey, Doc, guess what happened?"
"Well, it's quite obvious what happened. You stumbled and fell down like a clumsy oaf, but you're now able to accept this flaw in your character, so it's no longer necessary for you to keep a whistle in your mouth. Isn't that correct?"
"Well, partly, as you say, I stumbled and fell down like a clumsy oaf, but the main thing that did was to shake the whistle loose so it could fall out of my mouth. You see, it got stuck to my lips when I blew it right after I'd eaten a taffy apple. That's why I came here for emergency treatment."
"Well, if you told me that in the first place, I wouldn't have had to guide you through the long process of psychoanalysis."
"Well, the main thing is that I got well again. What do I owe you, Doc?"
"Well, most psychiatrists charge at least $50 an hour, but since your treatment was completed in less than that, I'd say $1.25 should be about right."
"Yeah, well, that sounds fair to me, too. So here you are.
Thank you.
And goodbye."
"Goodbye." "Well, Nurse Rudehouse, you've once again seen medical science enable a crazy mixed-up kid to start leading a useful life. So just enter the notation in your casebook, patient released, cured."
Join us again soon when the United States Mint, one of the nation's leading producers of money, will bring you another dramatic story from the files of the emergency ward. Welcome once again to Big Scoop, the documentary program that pays tribute to the nation's working newspapermen. Here at our main news desk, prepared to tell you about this week's Big Scoop Award, is our Big Scoop editor, Big Fred Scoop.
Thank you and welcome to the Big Scoop. This week's handsome certificate, together with a cash award of $15, goes to Vasily Hummert, ace reporter of the Butte, Montana Evening Territorial Dispatch. It was a keen sense of observation that set Vasily Hummert on the trail of his big scoop. One evening, just a little more than a year ago, he rushed in to tell the city editor about it.
"Hummert, how many times have I told you not to slam the door when you come into this office? I just get all the pictures hanging straight when you come in and slam the door, and they're all cockeyed again."
"Ah, I'm sorry, Chief. I just stumbled across a story that could be my big scoop. You remember that little Feddersen girl who was kidnapped up around Cut Bank about 20 years ago?"
"Of course I remember it. I cover the story myself."
"Chief, I'm convinced that the young woman who calls herself Phoebe Burnwell is really the Feddersen girl. I ran into Phoebe on the street this afternoon and noticed that she has a diamond-shaped birthmark on her wrist, just like the Fedison girl had. Chief, I want you to take me off my regular beat so I can dig up the evidence I need to print the story.
Hummet, you're playing with fire. The Burnwells are the most prominent family in town. If you're wrong about this thing, we'll have more libel suits stacked against us than we can handle.
Chief, as a working newspaper man, it's my job to expose evil wherever I may find it.
And so Vasily Hummert began piecing together pieces of evidence that were to add up to his big scoop. He visited the Burnwell home, intending to question the girl's mother without arousing her suspicions.
Mrs. Burnwell, I know you snatched that Fedison kid 20 years ago and have her posing now as your daughter. Why don't you come clean?
Why, that's the most absurd thing I ever heard of. If you'll wait a minute, I'll show you Phoebe's birth certificate.
Madam, don't make things worse with forged documents.
He visited the family doctor.
Doctor, I'm convinced that Phoebe Burnwell is really the kidnapped Fedison child. I need your help to prove it.
You're off your rocker, pal. I was there when Phoebe was born.
Doctor, you could lose your license for lying to obstruct justice.
And to clinch his case, Vasily Hummert took a picture of Phoebe Burnwell and showed it to the parents of the Fedison child.
Well, folks, what do you say?
No. She didn't look anything like that.
Well, see what the jury has to say about that.
Armed with the facts, Vasily returned to face his city editor.
Chief, I've run into a few bottlenecks. I'll need a little more time.
Hummet, you've run out of time. There are 5 slander suits pending against this paper as a result of your tomfoolery. You're fired. And don't slam the door on your way out. And so it was that Vasily Hummet reached the end of his newspaper career at the mute Evening Territorial Dispatch. The 5 slander cases were settled out of court for a total of $225,000. And Hummet is now working at a closed filling station in Great Falls. We're proud to have told you his story this week on The Big Scoop.
Okay, and let's talk to a gentleman here. He's waving semaphore flags. You wig-wagging to anybody in particular, sir, or is that just kind of a general distress signal you're sending out?
No, it's not a distress signal at all. I'm just notifying my buddy over the other side there of the studio where I'll meet him after the show.
Oh, you weren't able to find seats together, you and your buddy, huh?
Originally we had seats together, but then we moved. He moved anyway. His rabbit was afraid of that lady's turtle.
Okay, well, let's not start that discussion again. Let's hunt for somebody else to visit with. Maybe a
lady. I think I'd make a likely subject for that. I have some terribly interesting views on almost everything.
All right. Afraid I've already run into quite a few kooks today. I don't know whether you have something out of the ordinary to talk about.
Well, there's really nothing about me as unorthodox as all that. In fact, I'd be just a typical run-of-the-mill housewife if I had time to keep house, but you know how it is when you operate a Pony Express relay station.
No, I'll be frank with you, I really don't know how it is.
Well, you have to keep the fresh horses saddled up and ready, and of course, if the riders coming at you from both directions, body just doesn't get a minute's peace.
Ma'am, I don't know how you expect to get any sympathy when it's common knowledge the Pony Express stopped running almost 100 years ago.
Even the branch line between Flushing and Bayside?
Well, I don't think there was ever a branch line between Flushing and Bayside at all.
Well, I wonder where in the world those young punks go with all the horses I give them.
I don't know, but I hope you have fun hunting for them. And right now, back to Ray on the giant, flammable stage.
See, I've taken the liberty to dig into the mailbag a few moments ago because I believe it's been, at least a month since we answered any letters.
At least that.
Yeah, and this first one picked at random is from a lady up in Vermont who listens.
Lovely
and she
state.
Writes...
Beautiful state.
On either the 3rd or 4th of April, your show was not heard in our area because of a special political broadcast. Some local candidate babbled for hours about his plan to reduce the number of cows that wander across Vermont highways. And can you tell me what I missed by not hearing your show that day? Bob, I'm afraid I draw a blank on that one. Do you remember?
It took her a long time to write that question, didn't it? Was that the 3rd or the 4th, did she say?
Yeah, the woman doesn't seem sure of the exact date.
Well, that's not too important. I remember that we devoted the entire show on both days, the 3rd of April and the 4th, to a discussion of cows crossing Vermont highways.
Oh, yeah, I remember that now. Of course, we were in favor of having more cows on the roads up there. So all the woman really missed was hearing the other side of the argument.
Mm-hmm.
All right, well, let's move on to the next letter now.
Don't have any more. We'll try not to wait so long next time before we open up the old mailbag to answer all the cards and letters from you wonderful people out there. Hi, this is your old trail scout, Cheyenne, Wyoming, meandering your way with another tale of the Old West. Now, not many of us know the name of Hans Upmeyer, the first cattle baron of the Old West. Back in 78, Hans had just come from the old country, all eager and anxious to please. He was kind of dumb, but he was living proof of how a poor immigrant boy could get along real well if he had a mind to. First thing Hans Upmeyer did when he got to the panhandle, he changed his name. Well, what'll it be, stranger?
Well, I think a bill would do.
Yeah, coming up.
Looks like good beer.
Yeah, we keep it in satchels where the sun can't get at it. Say, I never seen you here before. What's your name?
Hans Up.
All right. I'll give you all the money you want. Just don't pull a gun on me.
But...
here's the money. $1,600, all I got. Take it and get out of here.
I think I settle in this town. Yeah, I settle here.
Well, Hans Up didn't settle there. No, sir. Wasn't that he wasn't a sociable man. It's just that after he introduced himself to everybody in town, well, he kind of stopped talking to him, so he moseyed along. Went north to the Dakotas, shouting his name at people all during the long ride. He arrived in Deadhead a rich man.
Desk clerk? Where's the desk clerk?
Right here, mister. You want a room?
Yeah, I want a room with a bat.
That'll be $4 in advance, mister. Sign the register.
Good. I'll give you the money right after I sign. Where do I sign?
Right there, mister.
Hands up.
Oh, not again. This is the sixth time this week the place has been stuck up. Here, take this. Just about cleans me out.
What's the number of my room, please?
Say, you're certainly a cool customer for a fellow who just stuck me up. I better not fool around with you. Your room is 217.
Thank you. All the streets are paved with gold, but all I guess...
Well, it wasn't too long before Hans was a cattle baron, owned just about everything in sight. That is, until the Indian uprising. You see, while his house was being burned to the ground, he thought he might as well try to be sociable with the chief of the Indian party. What name you go by, owner of house burning to ground?
Hands up.
Well, I'll be darned if he didn't get something for the mention. An arrow in his chest. And for right now, Trail Lounge, this is Cheyenne, Wyoming, loping out of sight till the next time. Till then, keep them holsters full. Right now, welcome to the Collector's Item Show, kind of a special feature where we welcome our guests to the studio. They're here to tell us about the rare and unusual items they've collected. And a quick glance at my card indicates our first guest is Mr. Ben Aldorf. What did you bring with you today, Mr. Aldorf?
Well, I thought you might be interested in seeing this piece of wood.
Not unless it has a background, I wouldn't.
Well, I'm no fool. I understand that the things on this show are supposed to be rare and unusual.
Right.
Now, this piece of wood... it's off the original deck of Robert Fulton's steamboat.
Really? You mean that piece of wood you got there was probably walked on by Robert Fulton?
Probably. I know it was. It came off the floor of Fulton's cabin.
Certainly is a beautiful piece of wood. Would you describe it for our
listeners? All right. It's about 4 inches long, about 2 inches thick, except where it's splintered and slopes off at the end. The deck paint is in good condition, except for the splintered end, where the natural color of the wood shows through.
See that the splinter is about an inch long and very, very thin, about a, well, 16th of an inch, I'd say.
Pretty close. I've got to be very careful with that splinter. Usually I keep it covered with absorbent cotton. But I knew you'd want to look at it, so I uncovered it.
Well, I appreciate your confidence in me, Mr. Aldorf. Could I hold the piece of wood that came off Robert Fulton's steamboat?
Well, I have to put it in a plastic bag full of grass, just as a precaution, you understand. It's no reflection on you.
All right, no, I know. Put it in the bag, then. I understand.
All right, there it is. Take a look at her.
It's a little disappointing. I can't see too much with all that grass covering it.
Well, that's the best I can do. I can't take any chances with a thing like
that. We understand, and you're a fortunate man, Mr. Ben Aldorf. Priceless possessions don't often fall into the hands of the ordinary person. Good luck.
Thank you.
Thank you for being with us. And now we have Mrs. Helen Baffle with a collector's item to show me. Just what is the item, Ms. Baffle?
One of the strings off Nero's violin. The one he played while Rome was burning. Look here, you can see where it singed.
Oh, made the string turn color a little bit, too, didn't it?
Well, I think that end of the string turned color because that's where I hold it when I show it to people.
Mrs. Baffle, if you don't mind the suggestion, I'd mount the string on a board if I were you. One end of it's beginning to curl.
Well, it started to curl about 2 years ago.
Did that panic you?
No, I took it to a music shop where a violin expert rubbed it with a strengthening agent. It used to be curled much more than what you see now. Incidentally, I thought you might like to know that the string is in such good condition it can be played on.
It's amazing. After all, it's very old.
Now, I brought a bow here to the studio, and if you hold one end of the string, I can hold the other and still have a free hand left to fiddle on it. Here, take one end. You got
it? It's so thin, it's hard to tell. I think I've got it.
All right, now, listen to this.
That's fantastic.
Isn't it?
Yeah. What makes it even more amazing is the fact I wasn't holding the other end of the string. I dropped it before you started playing. I'd look into that bow you've got there, Mrs. Baffle. That's a real collector's item, too.
Well, I'll look into it if you say so.
I think you should. And now, Mushies, the great new cereal that gets soggy even without milk or cream, brings you another exciting story of adventure starring Tippy, the Wonder Dog. As we look in on the isolated cabin of Grandpa Witherspoon today, we find that Gramps is making preparations to celebrate his birthday. Meantime, little Jasper stands in the front window, gazing out at the neighbors as they pass by without stopping. Suddenly, the boy turns and speaks.
Looks like nobody remembered your birthday, Gramps. The neighbors are all passing by without stopping.
Yeah, consarn it all. I know they're passing by without stopping. Not a one of them ever remembers my birthday. That's why I'm planning to have a celebration all by myself. If that fool dog of yours ever gets back with the candles for the cake.
Oh, you don't need to let that cast a shadow of worry over your big day, Gramps. Tippy's entering into the full spirit of the occasion.
Yeah.
You can just bet on that. Tippy is the dedicatedest, the smartest dog in the whole wide world.
Well, consarn it all. What's become of him, then? I sent him out for candles as soon as I decided to bake my special coconut layer cake with apricot frosting. And I reached that decision about noon last Thursday.
Oh, try not to be concerned, Gramps. You know how hard it is to find candles that are the right color to go with the apricot frosting. Tippy probably had to look over the whole selection at the general store. But he should be back any minute now. Tippy's the dependablest, the smartest dog in the whole wide world.
Well, consarn it all. When I was a young fella, everybody in the valley pitched in to help celebrate my birthday. Now I have to bake my own cake and leave all the other arrangements in the hands of a fool dog.
Avast! I think I see Tippy out there now, Gramps, loping over hill and dale to make this occasion truly memorable.
Here, Tippy.
Well, consarn it all. Let me have those candles. Cake's ready to take out of the oven right now.
Calm down, Gramps. That wasn't Tippy I saw out there after all. It was just the Mullahan's beagle headed home with an expensive crystal punch bowl.
Consarn it all. That beagle always remembers to buy the Mullahan's a present on their wedding anniversary. I can't get a box of birthday candles out of that fool dog of yours, even when I pay for them myself.
Ah, gee, Gramps, you make Tippy sound self-centered and ungiving. Actually, he's got a heart as big as all outdoors. He's the swellest, the smart... Wait, I see him now, for sure.
Here, Tippy.
Well, don't just stand there, boy. Give me the candles before that cake gets burned to a clinker.
Sorry, Gramps. As it turned out, that wasn't Tippy. It was just one of the puppies that hangs around the Miller place. He was headed up that way with a get-well card for old man Miller.
Well, that pup couldn't be more than 2 weeks old. He's already learned how to be thoughtful to his master. That fool Tippy never thinks of anybody but himself.
Ah, Gramps, you're just lashing out at the world because you think nobody remembered your birthday. But you can depend on Tippy. He's the wonderfulest, the smartest. Oh, wait. Oh, I see him for sure now. Homeward bound in a display of unswerving devotion.
Come on in, Tippy. That's a good boy.
Well, concern and all, I see the fool dog. Where are the candles I sent him for?
I guess he didn't bring them, Gramps. He seems to have spent your money on this bottle of vitamin pills instead.
Well, you can't put vitamin pills on a birthday cake. What's that fool dog thinking of, anyway?
Oh, wait, Gramps. Tippy's message is coming through loud and clear. When he heard how many candles you're going to need for your cake this year, Tippy realized that an old duffer like you should be fortified with extra strong vitamins. So he took matters into his own hands for your benefit and welfare. Boy, oh boy, didn't I tell you, Gramps, that Tippy's the brightest, the smartest dog in the whole wide world?
Today's hair-raising story of adventure was brought to you by Mushies, the great new cereal that gets soggy even without milk or cream. Join us again soon for more dramatic action starring Tippy the Wonder Dog.
And now it's time for another story of drama and tense emotion, a tale well designed to keep you in anxiety. And here with us again to set the stage for our latest thriller is the noted lecturer and world traveler, Commander Neville Putney. Commander, I assume you've reached into your amazing file and brought forth another tale well designed to keep us all in anxiety.
Yes, indeed I have, young man. It's a true story of two young men who set out on a madcap adventure, never dreaming it was destined to bring them face to face with anxiety. The central figures in today's tale were a pair of daredevil aviators, Brad Lunsbury and Thad Goftus. They were seeking fame and fortune by flying a single-engine biplane around the world nonstop when disaster suddenly struck. They were forced down somewhere in the Pacific, near the Philippines. And it was several days after they swam to a nearby desert island that Brad first spoke of their terrible plight.
We've been here 3 days now, Thad, and I'm afraid that means our plight is more terrible than we thought. If our last Mayday signal on the radio had been heard, I'm sure that someone would have been here by now.
I'll try not to give up hope, Brad. We could only report that we were bailing out over a desert island somewhere near the Philippines. Could take rescuers quite a while to cover the whole area.
But we don't even know for sure that we're somewhere near the Philippines. There was no time to plot our exact location, so we just made a guess.
True, true. I hope you haven't noticed that there's nothing out there on the horizon to indicate that we are anywhere near the Philippines.
Yeah, I didn't want to say anything, but I've noticed. There should be other islands in view or passing ships or something. There's just nothing, Thad. Nothing.
I know. I just hoped you hadn't noticed.
I've noticed. I've also noticed that there aren't any coconuts or anything else to eat on this infernal island.
No, I hadn't noticed that. But I'm afraid you're right. That clump of brush behind us certainly doesn't look edible. Neither of us likes fish, even if we were lucky enough to catch one.
So that means half a canteen of water is all we have. And under this blazing tropical sun, how long can that last?
2 days at most, maybe less. Perhaps we should get in that little patch of shade over there. It might keep our thirst from driving us mad until day after tomorrow.
What difference does one more day make? We have to face reality, Thad. No matter how long we hold out, we're never going to be found.
There. How about that for a bit of tense drama, young man?
Boy, it sure kept me in anxiety, Commander, but you got to tell us how the story came out. Did search planes ever find that little island where Thad and Brad were marooned?
No, but as it happened, they didn't need to. You see, Thad and Brad only assumed they were on a small island because they'd never gone around to explore the other side. Actually, they were on a peninsula within a short walk of the suburbs of Manila.
Oh, Commander, that's ridiculous. How could anybody spend 3 days on the beach, that close to a big city, and not see any sign of life?
Well, it's explained simply enough. You see, they were forced down on a Monday, so of course the area was deserted until the next weekend. That was when 200,000 vacationers from the city came out and took Thad and Brad back to safety with them on the streetcar.
Well, that absolutely is the most preposterous story you've ever made up.
Made up? Why, you young whippersnapper, every story I tell is a factual account that I've brought forth from my amazing file.
Yeah, well, your amazing file's got more lemons in it than a citrus grape.
Well, that'll be enough of that. I'll read the closing announcement, and I'll see to it that you're stripped of your rank and assigned to the boondocks.
Well, okay, after that, Dud, I sure feel foolish doing this, but I'll give it a try. Friends, be sure to join us next time when Commander Putney will again reach into his amazing file and bring forth a tale well-designed to keep you in anxiety. Again today, our scouts have been searching the railroad and bus stations for victims of hard luck who need a helping hand from our generous Bob and Ray organization. Bob, I assume that specimen there beside you is our first guest today.
Yep, he is, Ray. This is Mr. Torchy Fundrith of Oak Park, Illinois. Lovely town, and I understand that you're hoping to make a trip to Switzerland, Mr. Fundrith.
Well, that's right. I want to open a secret Swiss bank account and make a deposit, so I'm really anxious to get there in a hurry.
You know, I may be mistaken, but I understood that transactions with Swiss banks could all be handled by mail. I don't think you have to go there in person.
Well, I think you'd be right if I only wanted to deposit money, but I've gotten into a little trouble with the mob back in Illinois. So I thought I'd just rent a nice, roomy, secret vault in a Swiss bank and deposit myself into it until things blow over.
Well, I can understand your urgent desire to get out of circulation. You really think you can live comfortably in a Swiss bank vault?
Well, I think I could do that easier than I could breathe at the bottom of the Chicago River.
True, true.
That seems to be my only other option.
Well, our Bob and Ray organization is standing by to help you, just as it does so many other people, and here, just for you, we'd like to have you have this fine waffle iron from the Old Point Comfort Appliance Company. It can also be used for making grilled cheese sandwiches.
Well, I'm glad to hear that, because it sure wouldn't solve my problem if it only made waffles.
Now, with our next hard luck story, a lady is seated opposite me, Mrs. Wanda Blickford of Kenosha, Wisconsin. Miss Blickford, you've met with financial misfortune after coming to New York to further your professional career, is that right?
Yes, I was sure I had a great idea, but I thought I needed to operate in a bigger town than Kenosha. You see, my plan was to set up a computer matching service for people who buy mixed salted nuts.
I see, and you thought that was all two people needed to have in common to get married, am I...
Well, no, I wasn't using the computer to match them for marriage. My research had merely proved that each person likes one type of salted nut more than the others.
Mm-hmm.
So the idea was to match a pecan person with a cashew person, for example.
Uh-huh.
Then they could trade off their spares to get their favorites.
Well, that certainly sounds like an idea whose time had come, but I guess your business must have failed or you wouldn't be here pouring out your story of misfortune today.
Yes, the project really bombed, all right. And I'm really not sure why. I think maybe it's because I had to charge $50 a person to make the thing pay. So you'd have to eat an awful lot of mixed nuts to justify spending that kind of money on a computer matchup.
Yes, and during a recession, I guess some people think they have better things to do with $50. However, our generous organization wants to cheer you up in this time of disappointment, Miss Blickford. And with our compliments, here, you take this set of hand-woven covers for your golf clubs. So each one has a little tassel on top in a different color.
Well, I don't care about the colors of the tassels. I don't even play golf.
Okay, and now with today's final hard luck story, I'd like to have you meet Mr. Elton Dunsmuir of Joplin, Missouri. I understand, Mr. Dunsmuir, you encountered heartbreak while you were still in the process of moving here to New York.
Yes, you see, I'd planned to park my mobile home somewhere over here on Sutton Place and begin a new life. But it broke loose from the truck I was using to tow it just after I came out of the Lincoln Tunnel. And it's now parked kind of cattywampus across 54th Street and 10th Avenue.
Well, I guess cattywampus is a Missouri expression that means your home is blocking traffic.
Yeah, I guess you could say that. You see, it's one of those extra big mobile homes about 60 feet long. So my living room is up on the sidewalk on the northeast corner, and my kitchen is in the doorway of a drugstore on the southwest corner.
I see,
That's cattywampus clear across the street.
It certainly is.
My bedroom is directly over the manhole in the middle of the intersection. Guys from Con Edison keep coming up and pounding on the floor all night.
Well, I know how upsetting things like that can be, especially when you're trying to get your rest in a strange city. But we'll make your life a little brighter for you. Our Bob and Ray organization gives you, with its compliments, this all-steel, four-drawer filing cabinet from Aunt Martha's Office Supply Company, White River Junction, Vermont.
See, you guys really know how to help a fellow whose mobile home is stuck in the middle of a street.
You're entirely welcome. The least we could do, sir. Now back to Ray at our main anchor desk.
And now, the American Federation of Sheep Herders, representing 14,000 lonely people just like yourself, presents another episode of The Gathering Dusk, the heartwarming story of a girl who's found that misfortune is the key to unhappiness. As we look in on the Bessinger household today, Edna is putting new wallpaper over the portrait of her father in the downstairs hall. It's mid-afternoon, and Mr. Lohenbarger, the federal treasury agent stationed in the village, is just arriving.
Oh, it's you, federal treasury agent Lohenbarger. Long time no see.
Well, actually, I don't believe we've ever met before, Miss Bessinger. I guess you're one of the lucky ones who's never had a tax return audited by my office.
Well, that's not too surprising when you stop to think about it. I've never filed a tax return, so of course there's no way you could holler at me for doing it wrong.
Yeah, that's a very interesting theory. I must remember to check into your case when I get back to the office. Could I have your Social Security number, please?
Well, I hardly know what to say. Here we've just met, and you're already asking for my Social Security number. My, you are a sly rascal.
Well, I hope you haven't misunderstood my purpose, ma'am.
No, I think you made your intentions quite clear. Of course, it's been kind of a whirlwind courtship for an old-fashioned girl like me, but I won't stand on formality, so you just set the wedding date, and I'll get to work on the invitation.
Miss Bessinger, I'm not asking you to marry me. In fact, I already have a wife.
Well, I won't tell her about our plans if you won't. Besides, I assume a government official with your connections can beat a simple bigamy rap. Now, do you prefer a big church wedding or something simpler?
Neither one. I just want to find out why you've never filed an income tax return.
Well, we can discuss that on our honeymoon, but right now, we have so many plans to make for the wedding.
Miss Bessinger, there isn't going to be any wedding. I'm sorry.
Oh, that's all right. Don't apologize. I just thought I'd run the idea up the flagpole and see if anybody saluted.
Yeah, I understand. I just hope that's not the only reason you asked me to come over here.
No, no. I have something much more urgent on my mind, Federal Treasury Agent Lohenbarger. I've just come into possession of some money that I suspect is counterfeit, and I'm scared silly that I'll be sent away for a long stretch if your people should happen to break down the door and find it while they're searching the house.
Well, nobody on my staff goes around breaking down people's doors and searching their houses, Miss Bessinger. But I'll be happy to examine any money that you're suspicious about. Could be counterfeit, even though nothing like that has turned up in this area for several years.
Well, I'm almost sure that this stuff right here is phony. The frightening part is that somebody slipped it in my mailbox. I'm afraid that means they want me to pass a batch of it for them. But the risk would be terribly great.
Well, from this sample you've shown me, I'm sure there's nothing to worry about, ma'am.
Well, I think there's plenty to worry about. Just look at this terrible counterfeiting job. The thing is printed in blue ink. It's got a picture of a cat where Washington or Lincoln should be, and the denomination is 15 cents, which makes it suspicious right there. I'd be nabbed in a minute trying to pass this as real money.
Well, yes, that's probably true, but you're the only person I can think of who'd mistake it for real money, Miss Bessinger. It's obviously a coupon good for 15 cents off on the purchase of a can of cat food.
Great day in the morning. I do believe that is a possibility, Federal Treasury Agent Lohenbarger. And here I thought the counterfeiter was going to make me pass the stuff for him just because I'm a leading citizen here in the village with a reputation that's above reproach. My lands, you can't know what a burden this lifts from my shoulders, Federal Treasury Agent Lohenbarger. I suddenly feel as if I'm no longer standing in the gathering dusk.
Can it be that Edna's freedom from worry about having counterfeit money in her possession may at last enable her to find happiness? Or will it only lead to further heartbreak when she realizes that the coupon is good for 15 cents off on a brand of cat food that her cat won't eat? Join us for the next exciting episode when Edna may decide to pass up the bargain of a lifetime in the gathering dusk.
And as you may know, one of the public services we occasionally perform is satisfying your curiosity about those little one- and two-paragraph feature stories that appear in the newspapers?
Papers run those human interest items every day, but they never seem to follow them up later to let us know how the stories came out. So every once in a while, we track down some of the people whose stories have appeared. We bring them here to New York at our own expense so they can tell you what eventually happened. Our first guest
was the subject of a United Press feature story several months ago. You're Mr. Hubert Wedlow of Harrisburg, Illinois, right, sir?
Yes, sir, that's correct. I became involved in one of those humorous foul-ups that computers are always making.
Oh, I know.
And, of course, the newspapers love to print feature items about that subject. I understand I got almost 2 full inches of space and more than 400 papers coast to coast.
Well, that's more publicity than most of us achieve in a lifetime, Mr. Wedlow. I understand that the computer mistake in your case was made on your weekly paycheck, is that right?
Yeah, I work for the gas company back home, and I'm supposed to make $162 a week.
Right.
But then 1 week the machine went haywire and issued me a check for $10 million. $162.
Wow.
Of course, I knew it was a mistake right away, and I couldn't keep the money.
Right.
But I showed the check to the local newspaper before I gave it back, and, well, the editor made quite an item out of it.
Well, I'm sure many of our listeners saw that original item, but then we never heard how your story came out. Were you rewarded or promoted for your honesty in giving back that $10 million mistake check?
No, sir. I was fired the next week. You see, the boss's wife is in charge of the payroll department. And the boss thought I should have come to him quietly instead of pointing out coast to coast how his missus was a dimwit for not catching a mistake like that.
Well, that's obvious from your shabby appearance that you haven't been able to find another job.
No, sir, I haven't.
We thank you for coming here to New York and taking time out to tell us the sad conclusion of your story. Our next feature story follow-up is from a lady, Mrs. Clara Shumbaugh of Moberly, Missouri. The AP ran a picture as well as a feature story about you, Miss Shumbaugh.
Yes, they had a photographer right on the scene at the Missouri State Fair when I won a blue ribbon for my giant cucumber.
Wow.
It was almost 2 feet long, and it weighed more than 19 and a half pounds.
Yeah, I remember seeing the picture in the paper, and the cucumber really was enormous, but I'm wondering what happened after that original story appeared. Did you sign any contracts to display the giant cucumber at other fairs?
No, in fact, the newspapers had barely hit the streets when we cut the thing open and found out it wasn't a cucumber. It was a watermelon with bumps on the outside. I can't imagine how it got mixed up with my cucumber display, and I felt awfully silly about the whole thing.
Well, you're a good sport to come here and tell us about it anyway. Let's have one more feature story follow-up. Here's Mr. Herbert Botchford of Cleveland. And I understand that the item about you appeared in almost 900 papers, Mr. Botchford?
Yes, sir. It was in the Cleveland Plain Dealer originally.
Uh-huh.
But then it was picked up by one of the national news services. And I heard later it was also carried throughout the British Commonwealth by Reuters.
Oh, it's amazing coverage. Now, just what was your story that attracted so much attention?
Well, I went out to my mailbox one day last April, and I thought it was kind of funny that one of the letters had real old Christmas seals on it. But then I also noticed there was just a 2-cent stamp on the front. So I examined the postmark very carefully.
Yes, I know you did. And to make a long story short...
Well, I don't usually make it short when I'm telling it.
Well, I know, but we're kind of running out of time here. What it all boils down to is that you received a letter that had taken 47 years to be delivered, even though it was mailed right in the same city.
Yes, sir, that's right. It was mailed in 1928. The post office people can't figure what happened to it all those years, but it finally turned up and got delivered.
Well, it's a mystery that may never be solved, but one thing you could clear up for us, sir, the news story didn't mention who that long-lost letter was from.
It was from the Internal Revenue Service, telling me that I owed another $10 on my 1927 income tax.
Well, I'm sure that small debt was canceled after you explained what happened.
Oh, you see, figuring compound interest for all those years, I now owe $9,433.67, and I can't pay it. So I'll be starting my prison term next week.
Well, I'm glad we caught up with you while you're still available. And I want to thank you and our other guests for stopping by today so we could learn how your feature stories came out.
All right, well, now it's time to pick up more valuable tips for you home handymen as we pay another of our regular visits to the basement workshop of Fred Falvey, the do-it-yourselfer. Fred, I see you've really beautified the workshop with all those potted cactus plants. Those are new since our last visit, I think.
Yes, they are, Ray, but those plants aren't primarily for decoration.
Oh.
You know, a cactus pulls moisture out of the air, so I bought these and transplanted them into pots with the aid of a few simple tools. Now they're keeping the basement dry for a good deal less money than a dehumidifier would cost.
Hey, that's quite an idea, Fred. Mm. I'm sure our beloved friends of the radio audience will want to dig up some cactus plants for that purpose the next time they're vacationing out west.
Yeah, it's always a good idea to have a few around the house when you live in the city. You can tap them for drinking water if your pipes have to be turned off for a long period. Cactus water doesn't taste very good, but it can keep you alive for several days after your neighbors have all died of thirst.
And you just cut a hole in the cactus to get the fluid out, is that it?
That's right. Number 5 paring knife is the best thing to use, but in a real emergency, almost any pointed chop tool will do.
So, there you have it, listeners. Just one more example of better living by doing it yourself. Fred, I'm sure our home handymen are all anxious, though, to hear about your newest project here in the basement workshop.
Right, and this week I have a fascinating new project started here in the basement workshop. It's this handsome thermometer. It can be placed on the wall inside the home or nailed to a tree in the yard, whichever you prefer.
Gee, it really is beautiful and useful, too. Would you explain to the handyman listening how you made it?
What I plan to do is explain how I made it for the benefit of the handyman listening in.
Good.
And it's really quite easy, too, with a few simple tools. The tube that holds the mercury is just an ordinary glass drinking straw. I sealed one end shut by heating the glass to the melting point with a standard acetylene torch.
Well, that seems fairly simple. Where'd you get the mercury to put inside?
Well, of course, you can always buy it in quantity on the New York Commodity Exchange, but you don't really need that much for one thermometer, so I got mine from condemned tuna fish.
Well, now, is that available on the New York Commodity Exchange, too?
I'm not sure about that, Ray, but the inexpensive source I found is a local fish cannery that had thousands of cases of tuna condemned because of excessive mercury.
Uh-huh.
And I merely squeezed each chunk of tuna here in this number 8 vise and then caught the drippings in a bucket.
And that's all pure mercury that drips into the bucket, is it?
No, it's mostly fish oil, just a little mercury mixed in. But, of course, the mercury is heavier than the oil,
sure. So
it sinks to the bottom after you've let the mixture sit for a few weeks. Then it's quite simple to get it out with an ordinary household ladle.
And then I suppose you just put the mercury in a glass tube with an eyedropper or something like that,
right? A standard number 6 eyedropper is the best thing to use for putting the mercury in the tube. And then you simply glue the tube to a nice piece of varnished lumber to complete your thermometer. Of course, you'll want to paint numbers down the side to indicate the various temperatures.
I see you have a number 64, excuse me, painted on the wood part. And is that you?
What?
Making that noise?
I wasn't aware of it, Ray.
It seemed like you were growling there. I see you have a number 64 painted on the wood part, and then a 72 above that, and then an 86. Yes, you are growling.
Am I?
Yeah, it's probably something you don't realize you do. 86 up near the top.
Yes, that's right. I just call the Weather Bureau occasionally to get the temperature, and then I paint in the figure they give me right at the point where the top of the mercury is. Of course, I'll have to wait until next winter to fill in the lower numbers near the bottom.
Well, it's going to be a real professional job when you're finished, Fred, and I'm sure it costs much less than you'd pay for a thermometer, say, in the store.
Oh, yes. I already had the glass straw and the lumber, so my only investment was for the $300 worth of condemned tuna fish. But I'll get most of that back as soon as I find a few of the neighbors who aren't afraid to eat it.
Well, that shouldn't be too difficult now that you've removed most of the poison by squeezing the fish in your vise. So, once again, fond listeners, we've witnessed a typical example of how to live better by doing it yourself, direct from the basement workshop of Fred Falvey, the do-it-yourselfer.